Ladies Study, Thursday evening, Chapter 18, What Will Happen When Christ Returns. Norbert's Baptism, we have a date, October 16th, at the Gunningsville Baptist Church, and a fellowship will be following here at the church. Doesn't have a time, so just says October 16th, Gunningsville Baptist Church. I would say we'd probably follow there. I don't know. We'll get that later, I guess. And also, thank you for all of you who joined together to do the cleaning last night. I showed up at the half hour before the announced time, only to find out that it was already done by the people that were here. So Aristide's not up there, but if he was, he could know that somebody beat me at the church earlier than he's been trying for a long time. So anyway, and it's nice to see Anise and Caleb here today, and hope it's Isaac has a bit of a stomach flu. Yeah, okay, so we'll just keep praying for everyone that's not feeling well. So, okay, and that's it for the announcements. Today I'll be reading from Psalm 33, I guess it's the whole psalm, verses 1 to 22. The steadfast love of the Lord. Shout for joy in the Lord, O you righteous. Praise befits the upright. Give thanks to the Lord with the lyre. Make melody to him with the harps of 10 strings. Sing to him a new song. Play skillfully on the strings with loud shouts. For the word of the Lord is upright, and all his work is done in faithfulness. He loves righteousness and justice. The earth is full of the steadfast love of the Lord. By the word of the Lord the heavens were made, and by the breath of his mouth all their hosts. He gathers the waters to the sea as a heap. He puts the deeps in the storehouses. Let all the earth fear the Lord. Let all the inhabitants of the world stand in awe of him. For he spoke, and it came to be. He commanded, and it stood firm. The Lord brings the counsel of the nations to nothing. He frustrates the plans of the peoples. The counsel of the Lord stands forever, the plans of his heart to all generations. Blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord, the people whom he has chosen as his heritage. The Lord looks down from heaven. He sees all the children of man. From where he sits enthroned, he looks out on all the inhabitants of the earth, he who fashions the hearts of them all and observes all their deeds. The king is not saved by his great army. A warrior is not delivered by his great strength. The war horse is a false hope for salvation, and by its great might it cannot rescue. Behold, the eye of the Lord is on those who fear him, on those who hope in his steadfast love, that he may deliver their souls from death and keep them alive in famine. Our soul waits for the Lord. He is our help and our shield. For our heart is glad in him, because we trust in his holy name. Let your steadfast love, O Lord, be upon us, even as we hope in you. What wonderful, wonderful words. Let's pray. O Father, creator of all things, our holy, eternal God, we thank you, Lord, for your steadfast love. We thank you for your faithfulness, Lord, even when we are not faithful. We thank you, Father, that you are with us, in all times, whether it be what we call times of joy or times of sadness, times when you celebrate the birth of a child, times when we mourn the death of a loved one. Father, you're with us. And we thank you, Father, that you gather us here together as your children to worship you and to fellowship with one another and to hear you speak to us. Father, be with a pastor as he brings forth your truth. And may we receive what we hear and feed on it and grow on it. And Lord, we pray for those who are sick. And I think of Isaac, and we thank you, Lord, for bringing him through the surgery and Lord, continually healing him. And Lord, as he just went through with the stomach flu and is feeling weak, Lord, we just pray for a speedy recovery from that. And for all those who are either sick physically or maybe even spiritually, Lord, we pray for your healing hand upon them. And Lord, I pray for my dad as he is near to be with you, Lord. I just pray that you'll keep him comfortable. And Lord, be with my family as we sit by his deathbed and just help us always to rejoice in you, even in this time. For my Father knows you, he loves you, and he knows you love him, and he's looking forward to going home. So Lord, we thank you and praise you. And Lord, now we would stand together and worship you and pray that you are pleased by what you hear. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Of power that can never fail. let their truth prevail over unbelief. How do you explain? How do you describe a love that goes from east to west and runs as deep as it is wide? You know all our hopes, Lord, you know all our fear. Words could not express the love we feel, but we long for you to hear. So listen to our heart, hear our spirit sing a song of praise that flows from those you have redeemed. And we will use the words we know to tell you what an awesome God are not enough to tell you of our love. Just listen to our hearts. If words could fall like rain from these lips of mine, if I had 1,000 years, I would still run out of time. So if you listen to my heart, every beat will say, thank you for the light, thank you for the truth, thank you for the way. And listen to our heart,
oh Lord, please listen.
Hear our spirit sing. Song of praise that flows,
a song of praise
from those you have redeemed,
those you have redeemed.
And we will use the words we know to tell you what an awesome God you are. But when words are not enough to tell you of our love, just listen to our heart. To my heart, every beat will say, thank you for the light, thank you for the truth, thank you for the way. And listen to our heart,
oh Lord, please listen.
Hear our spirit sing.
And hear us sing.
Song of praise that
flows,
from those you have redeemed. And we will use the words we know to tell you what an awesome God you are. But when words are not enough to tell you of our love, just listen to our heart. Words are not enough to tell you of our love. Just listen to our heart. Listen to our heart.
Oh Lord, please listen.
Listen to
Morning, everyone. I'm going to sound redundant, but you guys do look good. Before every sermon, every time I look up, it seems that whenever the Spirit of God is involved in either communicating His word, His people look good, especially when they hunger for the word. So let me pray that the Lord brings that into our hearts this morning. Heavenly Father, we commit ourselves in your hands this morning. We thank you for your presence. We thank you for your work. We thank you for your spirit. We thank you, Lord, for the blood of Christ that had been shed on the cross for us. We pray that by his blood that we will find ourselves today hopeful, cheerful, gracious, and willing to live a life, the life that you have set aside for us. So do, during this hour, as you please. Our hearts are yours. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. All right. Now, today we're looking at day two of creation. I was wondering if I'm going to go day by day or just do like everybody else, take all of the days together and do one sermon. But it looks like day two, it got to be one sermon. So I try to fight God on that, but there is material. So today we're looking at second day, the curtain of heaven. I'm just going to read that text for us in Genesis chapter 1, verses 6 to 8. Then God said, "Let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters, and let it separate the waters from the waters." God made the expanse and separated the waters which were below the expanse from the waters which were above the expanse. And it was so. God called the expanse heaven. And there was evening, and there was morning the second day. So I'm just simply going to break down this second day description into four points. The word of creation, we can call them the four aspects of the second day of creation. The word of creation, the spread of creation, the efficacy of creation, and the minutes of creation. Now we remember that on day one, when God created the heavens and the heavens became the canvas of his creation, because there was nothing in it, right? There was no stars, therefore there was no galaxies that were in the heavens. It was simply a blank canvas and the earth. Maybe that's why back in the day the church thought that the earth was the center of the world, and they were willing to kill people who said different. Well, it wasn't the center of the galaxy, and it's certainly not the center of the universe, but it's the center of God's creation. Not centered geographically, but qualitatively and relationally. The earth was the center of God's creation. So when he says the earth was formless and void and darkness was over the surface of the deep, we know it wasn't surface per se, but throughout the deep. That deep is the deep space. Now we have a formless, void earth, and within it God separated the light from the darkness. We also know from day four and day five that there will be in the expanse of the heavens lights that he will put in there. So when he creates light on day one, we know it's not the sun, it's not necessarily a source of light like the stars, but it's simply the material that will be made, that makes up light. It's only on day four that we're going to see the sun. The moon is actually not a source of light, but reflects the light. and also the stars. And so in the word of creation, as we start the description of the second day, the first thing we encounter, the first thing we notice is that God said again. God speaks things into existence. It reminds us of Psalm 33, verse 4, that says, "For the word of God is upright, and all his work is done in faithfulness." Verse 6, "By the word of the Lord the heavens were made, and by the breath of his mouth all they contain." God speaks things into existence. Yes, he could have called someone to do it. He could have created man and said, okay, now create this. I'm going to give you the directions to create or to do whatever, like he did for Noah, who never saw a ship before, and yet he built an ark. God could have led his creation to do it. He could have led the angels to do it. But no, he spoke these things into existence. Again, Hebrews 11:3 says, "By faith we understand that the worlds were prepared by the word of God, so that what is seen was not made out of things which are visible." What we see was made out of things invisible, not seen. I really want this verse to be the challenge of the day. It says, "By faith we understand these things." Because I'm going to bring you a lot of challenges to understand these things. So that leads us to the spread of creation, which is really the bulk of this message, the spread of creation. So God speaks and said, "Let there be an expanse," or a firmament, if you have the King James Version. "Let there be expanse in the midst of the waters." He decided to split the waters and create a space between them. Now, this is a formless earth, void, but now he seems to create a form. Not only a form, but put space between two bodies of water. We have the atmosphere that he creates within it, but we also have the hydrosphere, water cycles on earth. It looks like the hydrosphere back then is different from the hydrosphere today, because we do not have such an expanse above the heaven that he created. And of course, scientists are hotly debated this issue. But I want you to understand that as we're going to talk about science, science does not authenticate the Bible. By faith, we understand. Not by reason, we believe. By faith, we understand. Now, what kind of material or nature was all of this in? It's very difficult to know. It certainly is not the same aspect of creation as we see it today. But we know from the verse that God is the one who, as Isaiah says in Isaiah 40, verse 22, he stretches out the heavens like a curtain, and he spreads them out like a tent to dwell in. They knew that, they understood in the days of Isaiah that this description of the day two of creation was a spreading of space between two bodies of water. Whether they had a scientific understanding of it or not, I don't think they cared. They took the word of God for what it said. Now, there was enough in this new atmosphere to create, to give life. Henry Morris said the lower waters would provide a water base for living flesh and for earth processes, the upper waters would provide a sort of protective canopy of Earth's inhabitants. And the space between would provide an atmospheric reservoir to maintain the breath of life. Now, one thing we know is that whatever waters he's talking about above those heavens cannot be the that we see today. There's not enough water in those clouds to somehow fall on Earth as on the day of the flood. And even then, some scientists would say they could not have been those clouds of water droplets which now float in the atmosphere, because really at that time, Scripture says, there was no rain on Earth, right? Genesis 2:4. The Lord God had not caused it to rain on the land, and there was no man to work the ground. He had not created man yet, and he did not cause rain. But then how did he moisture the atmosphere or the ground? He says in verse 6 of Genesis 2, and the mist was going up from the land and watering the whole face of the ground. God made sure the hydrosphere was effective. When we read the account of the flood, in verse Genesis 7:11, he says, on that day of the flood, all the fountains of the deep burst open. So there is a vast amount of water coming from underneath the earth. But it says also the floodgates of the sky were opened. The floodgates of the sky were opened. It's not rain. It's just not tiny rain. This is heavy rain. Now, just to let you know, if we could take all of the water that is currently in the atmosphere and all of it falls on the ground, we only increase the water levels by 1.5 inches. That's not enough to flood the earth. So that's not the same amount of water that we had in the sky in those days. I don't think he deposited that much just for 1.5 inches of water. There must have been much more. Now, there are arguments that are made to explain what we understand as the waters above the expanse. And some call on that canopy theory, a canopy of water, whether it's in form of ice, in form of water, in form of water vapor. Henry Morris, which is probably the father of creationism, brought the first, not the first, he kind of stood on others, but because of his scientific background, he expounded on the water vapor theory. He says, water vapor, even in vast amounts, is invisible, whereas clouds, fog, or so forth, are composed of minute droplets of liquid water and are therefore opaque. Furthermore, a vapor canopy could be easily maintained aloft and would serve much more effectively as a marvelous sustainer of vigorous life conditions on Earth. It can be shown that such a canopy would accomplish the following services. For example, I'll give you 9 of them. Number 1, since water vapor has the ability both to transmit insofar incoming solar radiation and to retain and disperse much of the radiation reflected from the Earth's surface, it would serve as a global greenhouse, maintaining an essentially uniformly pleasant warm temperature all over the world. Number 2, with nearly uniform temperatures, great air mass movements would be inhabited and windstorms would be inhibited. Great air mass movement, like storms, great winds would be inhibited, and windstorms would be unknown. Number 3, with no global air circulation, the hydrologic cycle of the present world could not be implemented, and there could be no rain except directly over the bodies of water from which it might have evaporated. Number 3, with the global air circulation, and therefore no turbulence or dust particles transported to the upper atmosphere, the water vapor in the canopy would have been stable and not precipitate itself. Number five, the planet would have been maintained not only at uniform temperatures but also at comfortable uniform humidities by means of daily local evaporation and condensation, like dew or ground fog, each day-night cycle. Number six, the combination of warm temperature and adequate moisture everywhere would be conducive later to extensive stands of lush vegetation all over the world, with no barren deserts or ice caps. Number seven, a vapor canopy would also be highly effective in filtering out ultraviolet radiations, cosmic rays, and other destructive energies from outer space. These are known to be the source of both somatic and genetic mutations, which decrease the viability of the individual and species, respectively. And so the canopy would contribute effectively to human and animal health and longevity. Number eight, some have objected to the idea of a heavy vapor canopy because of the great increase in atmospheric pressure, which would cause at the Earth's surface, which would cause at the Earth's surface. Rather than being a problem, however, Henry Morris finds it this effect would contribute still further to health and longevity. Modern biomedical research is increasingly proving that such hyperbaric pressures are effective in combating disease and in promoting good health generally. There would be no problem in organisms living under high external pressures, provided the internal pressures had time to adjust correspondingly. And number nine, later, when needed, these upper waters would provide the reservoir from which God would send a great flood to save the godly remnant from the hopelessly corrupt population of that day. Many creationists adopt this theory of canopy. There are many benefits. It fits the biblical account, especially if the health benefits would lead to longevity, because that we know from Old Testament, especially before the flood, of people living very, very long lives. We also have the giant animals that we don't see anymore today. We only we are impressed by their sizes, but we know they cannot survive in today's atmosphere. And yet they reigned in their days. This theory seems to give a lot of good explanation. So that leads us to number three, the efficacy of creation. See, among creationists, there is much disagreement about this canopy theory. Robert Kofal, for one, says that this theory actually is contrary to the laws of sciences. It brings issues that are contrary to the laws of sciences. And he wrote, critical analysis of these models show that the provision of a substantial part of the flood waters or of ice, either from a canopy or from extraterrestrial sources, is impossible apart from special, divine, miraculous intervention. Science does not explain this theory. You need to have some sort of miracle that is added to the mix. The second one, another scientist would say, bring up another problem. He says the potential energy of the water would be converted to kinetic energy or heat as it fell to the earth, heating up the atmosphere to such an extent that life could no longer exist. A third problem brought by Robert Whitelaw says there is really no known physical law that exists today that shows that pure gas, like water vapor, can maintain a boundary with another air, that you can have water vapor and air next to it and do not mix. They simply stay separate. It simply doesn't happen. There is no way to know. There's another scientist says any canopy proposal involves conditions which no longer exist. Proponents engage in theoretical discussions about completely hypothetical former atmospheric configurations, including complicated mathematical expressions and tables of calculations. None of the canopies which have been proposed is plausible. Gary Johnson writes, "It appears that a miracle is necessary for any canopy model, either to hold the water up or to get it down without destroying the earth." Walter Brown also maintains that the arguments for the various canopy theories do not stand up when examined closely. These theories also contain many biblical and scientific problems, such as those associated with heat, light, pressure, support, nuclei, and ultraviolet light. Even the best known canopy advocates privately acknowledge these problems. Canopy theories have led many in the creationist movement down a dead end street, delaying our understanding of the flood. The flood water came from below, not above. Failure to understand this has caused many to doubt the historical accuracy of the flood account and therefore the Bible itself. These are creationists amongst themselves. We don't need evolutionists to fight, right? We need brains with limited abilities to fight. But I'm going to tell you this. When I read this text, God said, "Let there be an expanse in the midst of the waters," and he separated the waters from the waters. God made the expanse and separated the waters which were above, which were below the expanse from the waters which were above the expanse. And he says something next. "And it was so." I don't care what your theory is. God said, "It was so." There was water above, there was water below. If your math doesn't add up, it's not God's problem, because you weren't there. He was. He did it, you didn't do it. So we listen to God, who said, "It was so." If we find out the math adds up, great. You found it, okay? But you did not authenticate Scripture. Whether you understand it or not, whether eventually we come up with a scientific explanation for it or not, God said that's how he did it. And if we cannot imagine, it's not even observe. I mean, sure, we can observe. It's not the same anymore. We cannot even imagine it. We imagine and we start fighting like all them PhDs together. Each one with his specialty coming here and saying, no. This is according to geology, this is how it works. Well, no, if you go to quantum physics, it doesn't work like that. This would have been the problem that would be created by your theory. Well, you know, according to astrophysics, this is how it works. Well, we don't care. God knows all of that. God doesn't have a PhD. That's too low. He said it was so. So I love reading science to see how it could fit this. But whether I get to understand it or not does not add to my understanding of Scripture. Because I know even if our math adds up, it's still theories because we weren't there. It's way too complex to understand. See, when they fight, I want you to know this, okay? Sometimes it's above our, I would say brain grade, but it's also above our diploma grade. But they are fighting over assumptions. they say, according to my assumptions, your theory doesn't work. But your theory is based on assumptions. So they create their own assumptions and say, if we put these assumptions that are more reasonable than yours, then your theory doesn't add up. A better theory would be this. Nobody is fighting or bringing evidence. They are all bringing reasonings that are based on assumptions and the biblical text. I want you to know no one will ever bring facts alone, because it requires you, or it requires the person, to first of all build a time machine and take you there and make you observe all of that and take all the scientific data and come back and find whether the results are right. Until then, well, chances are if that happens, you're probably dreaming. But all I'm saying is, trust the Lord. At the end of the day, trust the Lord. It was so. I want you to notice another point here. There is a series of separations that are taking place. In verse 4, day 1, we saw him separate light from darkness. Verse 2 now, verse 6 here in day 2, he's separating waters from waters and creates in there the heavens, as though he is making a distinction between heaven and earth. Day 3, in verse 9, he will be separating dry land from water. And day 4, verse 14, he will be separating the day from the night, light from darkness, but the day from the night. And day 6, in verse 27, somehow there is, in his creation of man, he has two men and women. When I bring up these separations, I want you to see that though he separates, there is a theological parallel in each one of those. And though at creation there is a separation, they will be all united in Revelation. As we have seen the light and darkness, there will be no more darkness in Revelation. Same thing we're going to see heaven and earth. See, there is a contrast between heaven and earth in Scripture. God creates this space, heaven. I mean, we already have the heavens declaring the glory of God. Now we have this other space in there between the waters and the waters. That is also called heaven. Now in Isaiah 55, we have this picture of the contrast between heaven and earth. He says, for as the heavens are higher than the earth, any of the heavens, the atmosphere, the cosmos, or the dwelling place of God, they are higher than the earth. So are my ways higher than your ways. See, the contrast between heaven and earth is compared to the contrast between God's ways and our ways. He says, for as the rain and the snow come down from heaven and do not return to heaven, but water the earth, making it bring forth and sprout, giving seed to the sower and bread to the eater. I just want to make sure that you understand. He says it doesn't return there. He's not talking about the cycle of water. He says returning to heaven without accomplishing the purpose. That's the next part of it. How do I know? Because in verse 7 he says, so shall my word. Just like water doesn't come down, doesn't come return after it falls down, so shall my word that goes out from my mouth, it shall not return to me empty. I mean, it will return to me, but not empty. So God is not making a scientific mistake by saying water doesn't return to heaven, because it does return through condensation, but not without having watered the earth not without having provided the benefits that it needs to provide to the earth. So shall his word. So you can see that the ministry of heaven is to the earth, not the other way around. Heaven ministers to the earth, just like the word of God ministers to us. That's why in Ecclesiastes 5:2, the preacher says, "Do not be not rash with your mouth, nor let your heart be hasty to utter a word before God. For God is, and you are on earth. Therefore, measure your words." Based on the fact that these are two different places, one is much higher than the other. And so we do not speak into the higher place without measuring our words. Therefore, the water that goes from earth to the heaven through condensation is not more important than the one coming down. Because the one coming up is not ministering to heaven. It's a tool of heaven to minister to you. The sky, water, we do. Heaven doesn't need our words. We need heaven's words. Now, I say that, but I do not want to convey to you that somehow the earth is forsaken or unholy. See, Isaiah 66 in verse 1 says, "The Lord said this, heaven is my throne and earth is my footstool." It looks lower, but it's the footstool of the throne of God. It doesn't matter how low it is. If God says it is mine, it is holy. That is why even in Matthew 5:34, he says, "I tell you, do not take an oath at all. Don't take an oath by heaven, because it's the throne of God. Don't take an oath by the earth, because it is footstool. Don't swear by it." Psalm 132:7, "Let us go to his dwelling place. Let us worship at his footstool." Exalt the Lord our God, Psalm 99:9, "and worship at his holy mountain, for the Lord our God is holy." So when I go to the footstool of the throne of God, I worship there because God is holy. So that said, just because it's not heaven doesn't make it thing to speak evil of. It's still for God, but it's different from heaven. It's different from heaven because it's earthly, it's physical, and we made the distinction between the spiritual and the physical. That's why when Paul speaks to the men of Athens in Acts 17:24, he says, "The God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, he does not live in temples made by man." They cannot contain him. And certainly, they are not worthy of him. So this separation between heaven and earth is a great picture of the contrast between the purity of the dwelling place of God and the corruption of the dwelling place of man. That is why in Matthew 6, for example, in the Lord's Prayer, "Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come." We don't want to live on our own kingdom. We want your kingdom to come to us, because holiness is over there, corruption is here since the fall, and we want more of you with us. And sure enough, as we progress through the revelation of Scripture in the New Testament, Jesus reveals to us through his rebuke to the Pharisees that, listen, where are you looking for the kingdom of God? Your kingdom of God is not there or here. The kingdom of God is in your midst. But what does he mean by that? He means God is with you. Emmanuel. See, God has bridged that place because of our wretchedness, and he needs and he wants to share his glory, his holiness with us. He bridges the gap. He bridges that chasm between him and us through Christ our mediator. And see, if you continue to look on that lens to Revelation 21, the same text we read last time, to see the light and darkness coming together, where there is always going to be light and God will be our light. Same thing happens here. He says, then I saw a new heaven and I saw a new earth. The dichotomy we saw before now is coming to a certain climax here. He says, for the first heaven and the first earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. And I saw the holy city, the New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven. And it came down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And he says, behold, the dwelling place of God is with man. The separation we see between heaven and earth, we see it return to what God intended it to be. God with man. And that leads us to that fourth portion. The minutes of creation. We see in the text, God says, verse 8, God called the expanse heaven. And he calls that the second day. God writes the story of redemption both in creation and in the revelation through his prophets. I cannot stress this enough, that our heart is in listening and hearing God. There are many, many pressures to not trust what God says. But understand this, these minutes, the record of creation has been with us now for 2,000 years. More than that, Old Testament, I mean, Moses wrote it over 5,000 years. But I tell you what, science has changed so many times just in the last 400 years. You will always have more and more scientists, more and more atheists, more and more agnostics who would come and give you seemingly new arguments. None of them are new. The Bible has been written thousands of years ago. This account of creation is timeless. If you do not understand what they say, you know what? Just tell them what we know for sure. Because God says it was so. He made sure that we have it in writing. He made sure that when the people who come and say the Bible is wrong, they will die. The Bible will stay. Somebody else will come and pick up from where that dead person left off and say, no, you know what? He was right. The Bible is wrong. That person is going to die. And the Bible is going to stay. And it's been this cycle for millennia. And the church has been growing crazy. They will always be children of God. Look at the testimony of Scripture. If you can't understand the science, Like Christ says, at least believe the works. God said it. Lives have been changed, and they continue to change, and they continue to affect mankind. A lot of people say, well, I wait for God to tell me. I wait for God to tell me. He's been telling this for centuries. Don't wait anymore. Just start reading. What a God. What a God. Psalm 104, bless the Lord, O my soul. O Lord, my God, you are very great. You are clothed with splendor and majesty. God established the earth upon its foundation so that it will not totter forever and ever. You covered it with the deep as a garment. The waters were standing above the mountains. Can you imagine the waters above the mountains? And at your rebuke, you simply said the word, they fled. At the sound of your thunder, they hurried away. The mountains rose, the valleys down to the place which you established for them. You set a boundary that they may not pass over, so that they will not return to cover the earth. What a God. What a God. If science cannot land here, it's not science. It's just empty debates. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for the picture of your greatness, the picture of your glory. We thank you, Lord, for knowledge. We thank you for science. We thank you for everything that you have given us to make our lives easier and more comfortable and more enjoyable. I plead with you this morning, Lord, that all of these things that you have given us so we can enjoy life on earth and so we can serve you more appropriately, that you would help us use them for your glory. That you will help us use science for your glory. That you will help us use the resources on earth for your glory. Father, let us not, do not abandon us to our own reasonings, to our earthly understandings, but give us faith so that by faith we can understand. Make us men and women of faith, and therefore open our minds and our hearts to receive truth, to understand the world as you intend for it to be understood. Help us grow in knowledge, but the knowledge that gives you glory. We commit ourselves in your hands in the precious name of Christ our Lord. Amen. Oh, that's right. Beautiful. Well, well, well. This is definitely an appropriate time. God made everything. He speaks the word, and God speaks the word. Church, remember this time. Now, we are, unlike creation, we are stubborn. But by God's grace, he has given us the privilege to put that in practice. He says, every time you do this, do in remembrance of me. And this is our greatest privilege. There is nothing that is more honoring to mankind than to exalt, to promote, to display the name of Christ. And today we do it because we stand before him blameless. That's why it is for us not the Lord's or Providence Supper, but the Lord's Supper. So I do insist that we check our hearts before we take it. The Lord's Supper simply means that the Lord is the one who ensures that it is done worthily. And he calls us not to take this in an unworthy manner, but rather check our own hearts before we take it. If sin prevents you to take the Lord's Supper, then that's an irony, because it's because of sin that we can take it. Therefore, sin should not be your stumbling block, but rather the very reason why you go to God in repentance. So let us take time to examine ourselves. For your information and maybe for future reference, examining ourselves is particularly a prayer of repentance. It's a prayer to say, I acknowledge my wretchedness. And if there is a particular sin that causes you maybe guilt so that you don't feel like you should take it, that's the sin you repent of. That's the sin you bring to the cross. Because nothing can separate you from the love of God in Christ Jesus. And so when in the night that the Lord was betrayed, he took this cup, and so I'm going to ask Daniel and Jean-Marc, would you mind? The Lord took this, the bread, and he broke it. And this bread was the symbol of his suffering. The symbol of this pure body that was broken, that was abused unjustly. One who knew no sin became sin for us. One who had no defect became broken for us. A beautiful picture of the Lord's grace and of his humility. See, when we take the Lord's Supper, it drives us to humble ourselves under his hand. He says, this is my body which is for you. Christ did not need a body for himself. Christ did not need to exalt himself. He was already exalted. He came from a place of highest exaltation so that he will take our place. The picture of heaven coming down on earth. The picture of righteousness coming among the unrighteous. Christ simply exemplified the picture of this sermon. As he created heavens, he separated heavens from earth. And now, in the picture of the supper, Christ says, I'm bringing righteousness in your midst. I'm bringing holiness in your midst. So this is my body, which is for you. Let us do this in the remembrance of Christ. Let's take the body. And after supper, he took the cup and says, this cup is the blood of the covenant. This new covenant, this new contract in his blood is to give you, to sanctify you, to purify you. As we take it, we're saying that I am righteous, not on my own account, but on the account of Christ, because all of my unrighteousness have been wiped clean. And therefore, do not let sin be your master. Rather, let Christ be your master. Let us take the cup. Father, we thank you for this highest privilege to proclaim your death. We pray for your mercy and the grace to continue to do this until you come. For this is your word, and you need only to say the word, and it will be so. Preserve your church, Father, so that we will continue to serve you, to glorify you, to advance your kingdom, to exalt your name and proclaim it in every street, by any means necessary, because you're worthy of it. We pray this in the precious name of Christ. Amen. So as a way to enact the covenant that we have with Christ, we also practice covenant with one another. And let us remind ourselves of that covenant. Having been brought by God's grace to repent and to believe in the Lord Jesus Christ, we now, depending on the Holy Spirit, establish this covenant with one another. In all we do, we will aim to glorify and enjoy the God of our salvation, from whom and through whom and to whom are all things. To him be all glory forever. We will eagerly maintain the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace by walking together in love and in the Spirit, and by putting away all bitterness, anger, and injurious speech. With humility and gentleness, patience and love, we will be kind to one another, tender-hearted, forgiving each other, even as God, for Christ's sake, has forgiven us. We'll carry each other's burdens, rejoicing with those who rejoice and weeping with those who weep. We will train our children in the instruction of the Lord, seeking to walk in a way that adorns the gospel of Christ before our family, friends, and neighbors. We'll strive to live self-controlled, upright, and godly lives in this present age, as we wait for the blessed hope, the appearing of the glory of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. We will not neglect to gather together, but will support and treasure the biblical preaching of the whole counsel of God, the faithful observance of baptism and the Lord's Supper, and the loving exercise of church discipline. We will contribute cheerfully and generously to the expenses of the church, the relief of the poor, and the advancement of the gospel, both to our neighbors and the nations. We will, when we move from this place, unite as soon as possible with some other church where we can carry out the spirit of this covenant and the principles of God's word. In all these things, we rely on our God, who's made a new and everlasting covenant with us, saying, "They shall be my people, and I will be their God. I will give them one heart and one way that may fear me forever for their own good and the good of their children after them. I will not turn away from doing good to them, And I will put the fear of me in their hearts that they may not turn from me. I will rejoice in doing them good with all my heart and all my soul. Together, may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all. Amen. The deep love we have in Christ. Well, let us pray. for the food before. Heavenly Father, we thank you for all of your provisions. We thank you for the beautiful day. We thank you for the sun. We thank you for our health. We thank you, Lord, for brothers and sisters in Christ. Thank you for family and friends. Lord, you give us so much under this earth. And today, once more, you have provided for our meals. We pray that you bless the time we have together, bless the meal, bless each hand, Lord, that made it, and would you strengthen them to continue to bless others. This time is yours, Father. As we have enjoyed the Lord's Supper, we pray that you would also give us the blessing to enjoy the fellowship of the supper. Commit ourselves in your precious hands. Amen. May the Lord bless you and may he keep you. May the Lord make his face to shine on you and to be gracious to you. May he lift up his countenance on you and give you his peace. Amen.